Hello viewers, it's my pleasure to welcome you all for learning the civil engineering concepts. Hello viewers, in this video I will discuss about the fundamental concepts of design of footings. The outline of this presentation is, from this video you will learn what are the requirements for design of the foundations. Finally, you will learn about what are the different failure modes of the footing, how it will govern the design. Let us discuss with the pressure distribution of footing. Here, I am applying the load not through the CG. It was some distance from the CG. In that case, we will see how will be the pressure. I am assuming here two loads. One is acting a down load, one is acting at up load with the magnitude of P, the same column load P. Whether the equilibrium will be affected? No. Because we are applying the download load magnitude of P, upward also P, it will be finally effect, net effect will be zero. So equilibrium will not be affected. Now I am considering these two forces, this one and this one. I am considering these two forces. What about the nature of these two forces? These two forces are parallel forces, equal in magnitude, opposite in direction, will form a couple. Okay? Due to this, it will form a couple. I will replace this load, this eccentric load, by like this. Load P with moment magnitude M. M is equal to P into E. E is the eccentricity. Yeah. So, if we have a load and moment means, what about the pressure distribution diagram, sir? See, this one is the pressure distribution diagram for that one. For load, we can easily calculate by, we know the simple formula, stress equal to load by area. So, we can get the S here. Then, what about the moment, sir? For the moment, we know the simple bending equation. M by I equal to F by Y equal to E by R. From that, F equal to M by Z, bending stress. That also has to be considered. So, here you will have a maximum pressure of P by A plus M by Z. Because this is the direction of this load, you have a maximum pressure here. You have a minimum pressure of P by A minus M by Z here. So, in this case, pressure is non-uniform because of this eccentricity. So, in this case, eccentricity will be E is less than V by 6. We know that eccentricity is less than or equal to V by 6 means the whole base is under compression. The whole base is under compression. So, this is the case for E less than V by 6. For example, if E equal to B by 6 means, what about the minimum pressure? Maximum pressure will be there. Minimum pressure will be equal to 0. You can easily check this condition by substituting the values in this equation, where P is equal to P, area equal to breadth into thickness, then M equal to P into E, then for then Z equal to, for rectangular section, PD squared by 6. You substitute these equations and equating this to 0, you can get the value of E equal to V by 6 or D by 6. This is the proof for this equation. So, worst case, this value minimum pressure can be equal to 0. It should not be go negative. Negative means what happened? Eccentricity is greater than B by 6. If eccentricity is greater than P by 6, means what will happen? Footing will be subjected to tension at some place. Okay, that I will show with one example. For example, this is a footing. If I am applying the load through the CG, what will happen? It will go like this. So, pressure will be uniform because I am coinciding the column load with the
soil pressure.
If suppose I am not coinciding this one, I am applying providing column here, means what will happen? This portion is under compression. This portion have a separation from the soil. That means it is having tension. Having tension. Because if you apply a load through the CT means you have a uniform pressure. If you apply a load eccentricity means that also it will under compression up to some extent, up to B by 6. If eccentricity is more than that means this portion will go down. That is having compression. This portion come up. It is having a separation from the soil. That means it is having tension.
Okay.
So to avoid tension, we can keep E less than or equal to B by 6. These are the requirements in design of foundations. The maximum pressure on the soil should not exceed safe bearing capacity of the soil. If it exceeds, means what will happen? Soil will fail. It can be failed by the local shear failure, general shear failure. Why I am telling the word maximum pressure? Because in the non-uniform pressure, here you are having a maximum pressure. Here you are having a minimum pressure. The maximum pressure should not exceed SBC of the soil. Okay? This is the first design requirement. Second one is settlement. Settlement cannot be avoided in the footing. There will be a small settlement is there. But the settlement should be within the permissible limit according to the code. For example, for clay soils having raft foundation and all means we can allow the settlement up to 100 mm. If the actual settlement is less than that means that will be okay. But in no case should not have a differential settlement. We have to avoid the differential settlement. If the differential settlement comes means what will happen? Cracks comes in the structure. So it is very difficult to differentiate settlement in my site, sir. In my site, have some of the area is having low bearing capacity, some of the areas having high bearing capacity soil. Then if I provide a same footing means what will happen? This low bearing capacity soil have a high settlement, this have a low settlement, what will happen? So the differential settlement will happen. To avoid that, you can independently provide footing for each other to set, allow for settlement. Okay? Whenever possibility of differential settlement occurs, the different portion of the structure should be made such as to settle independently of each other to avoid the occur of cracks in the structure. Next one is failure of the footing. The failure of the footing was mainly due to two forces. One is bending, another one is shear. Among these two, more severe will be the your shear, bending. Due to bending, how the footing will deflect? I will draw this diagram for that one. This is the column. This is the footing. This footing, due to this load, the footing will deflect like this. The footing deflect like this means what will happen? The bottom portion will experience tension. The top portion will experience compression. We know that concrete is strong in compression, weak in tension. Whenever tension occurs at that place, we have to provide the reinforcement. The reinforcement may be in the form of steel bars, aluminium bars or fibers. So due to this tensile force, tension means what has to happen? It will elongate. See the length of this one. Length of this line will be more than this length of this line. That means it is having tension at the bottom. Due to this tension, what will happen? Crack will happen. The thing. Crack will. Where the crack will occur? See the footing. See, this end is free end. This end is supported. So that means it will act like a cantilever. Okay. Are you agree with me? Does it make sense? Okay. The tension will be there. So here you will have a tension crack. So tension crack occurs at the column face. Tension crack always occurs at the column face at the bottom surface. That place only you are having tension. So the critical section for bending is at the face of the column. That's why we have marked here this. Then coming to the shear. We have two types of shears. One-way shear and two-way shear. One-way shear can be also called as a beam shear. The footing will act as a wide beam. The potential crack will extend up to the bottom through the cross section or the entire width of the footing. See here. Entire width of the footing it is occurring. Okay. The critical section for shear is at a D distance, that is the effective depth from the face of this column. According to IS 456, the critical section for one-way shear is at a D distance from the face of the column. Okay. How we can calculate the shear force? Here, the shaded area. The shaded area into upward soil pressure. Soil pressure in the unit of kilonewton per meter squared. Shaded area in meter squared. Then you will get the shear in kilonewton. Okay. Then coming to the two-way shear. It is also called as punching shear. How we can avoid the punching shear? It is a more critical one in the footing design. Normally it will govern the design of the footing. I will show one example for you. This is the footing, this is the column. Due to the load, column will puncture the footing. To avoid that, what we can do? Now I am doing one method of increasing the resistance of the punching shear. By increasing the thickness of the footing, now I am applying the column load. What happened? They have a more punching resistance. This is the one way to increase the punching resistance. The other way is, instead of having a pointed edge, if I use this other end, this punching shear resistance will be more. Punching shear resistance of the footing is more. So, here, instead of this material, if I use this material, I am applying the column load. And the punching is not there. So, punching shear resistance can be increased by three ways. One is by increasing the thickness of the footing. If the thickness of the footing is more, means punching will not happen. The second one is, we can increase the bearing area of the column. Instead of having small head, if you increase the bearing area of the column by providing more size at the junction of the footing, means punching shear resistance will be more. We have seen the site in many places they have provided a increasing the size of the column at the junction of the footing. That is called pedestal. Pedestal is one way to increase the punching shear resistance. Third one is the material strength. We can increase the grade of the concrete. We can increase the percentage of the steel. These are the other ways to increase the punching shear resistance. Critical section for punching shear is occurs at a D by 2 distance from all the sides. Because it has to punch. No? The punching surface having a cracks in the circumference of the truncated cone here. Why it is called two-way shear means the critical section is considered on the both ways. One-way shear means it can consider in only one side. This is considered in both the sides. That's why it is called two-way shear. This is called one-way shear. Thank you. Your queries and the suggestions are welcome.